Good afternoon, everyone. Please settle down. Thank you, Daniel. Next up is Bits from DPL. During questions, please walk up to the microphones that's on the side. Helps make the question process a lot easier. So please welcome our DPL, Chris Ladd.
Since April, people have been asking me, what's it like being a DPL? And I sort of deflect and ramble on and, you know, talk about the internal and the external role of the DPL and things like that. And sometimes I might say something like, well, you know, has there real power, you know, making Debian great again, ramble around. this kind of thing. And it goes from but sometimes they ask, is it what you were expecting? And they often do this with a glint in their eye, as if they know something I don't. And this isn't coming from ex-DPLs, because you can sort of imagine that. What do you expect? I don't really know. But all I'm doing there is just deflecting, because what I really want to say and answer when people ask me that is, it's such an honor to be elected the project leader of Debian and things like that. Thank you for electing me, putting your trust in me, and you know all that. I mean, to a certain degree, I try and sort of fly under the radar in a sense. I mean, I don't write that much to the mailing lists, so I actually thought I'd just spend a couple of minutes just talking about myself. Again, to deflect that, mostly so I'm just a bit more approachable to you. You know, so if you are after something, you need something, you want someone to talk to, you know, shoulder to cry on, whatever, you know, I feel like you might know me a bit more, and then you'll be very happy talking to me. So this is my very first computer, which is actually a Not going into too much detail. A 5155, I don't know if anyone will recognize this. It's orange stream, CGA, things like that. Kind of cool. I really love the keyboard. Really, really nice. But my first, just moving on a few years, my first actual Linux distro was Red Hat. Yeah, sorry. And I got this from the Linux Emporium, which was a UK company that sent CDs to people before, you know, anyone has real internet. And I heard of Red Hat, you know, that's a thing, that's in magazines, I'll get that. Went to install it though, and it said, oh, I'm sorry, you need to install Red Hat 4 or whatever it was, 3 maybe. I got really annoyed because I'd spent, you know, £7 on this, you know. Which is a lot for me then, I was quite young. So I was like, oh, grumble, but luckily, when I ordered this, there's a box you can tick saying, send me any old CDs you've got lying around. Typically old releases of stuff that they just can't sell anymore. And this happened to be a Debian disk. So for all you archaeologists and historians, that's potato. And I still have the CD. This photo is from a few years ago. I don't actually own a CD drive, so when I found this, I actually went and downloaded an ISO and booted it. So yeah. So moving on a bit, my first Debian experience. Well, I was using it for a few years and things like that, you know, changing between KDE. But this is my first patch over a cold December. What you don't see here is that I actually screw up the control. Like I don't. I still can't use the BTS properly. Missing a control app there. But this was great, and so it wasn't just, I just felt great sending this off. This was an RC bug at the time in Lilypond. But what really got me is Thomas writing back saying, rock on, we'll get this into Edge. And that was just amazing. That was just like, wow, okay, I went from like, nothing to this is going to be in the release that was, I think it came out in April of the next year. And that was just so rewarding, and it was great, and I went to the Etch release party in Cambridge with Sledge and things like that. It was great, but it was this sort of enthusiasm that really got me there. And Thomas Bushnell's not around the project anymore, but we should all do more for this. And I was completely nobody then. First email for the BTS. So this was a real lesson to me, and should be a lesson to all of us. So yes, these days moving on from there, I became a GSOC student, Debian Live under Daniel Bauman. We did some cool stuff. I made a really nice interface for making live images and things like that. And this was a very fast-moving project at the time. I think we've updated the splash screen a bit since then. Then I did some X packaging. I added the Nouveau driver to Debian when that was all new and shiny. I have some random Debian-related hacks of my own, like the aptfs file system. You can mount this magic fuse file system and it pretends to be an apt repo and it unpacks all the source stuff for you. The Debian develop changes IRC was a disgusting twisted bot applying, but now someone else has to maintain that. And I did the normal packaging and everything under the sun. So these days I'm doing a lot of work on the reproducible builds project, which kind of keeps me interested, tickles my OCD at the very least. Differscope is a great tool to hack on, it's pretty cool. Also do long-term support, FTP assistance, sometimes accepting your packages, sometimes rejecting your packages. Recently just got back into some Lintian hacking, so that's all pretty cool. So that's just a sort of summary of what I'm doing. Hopefully I'm a little bit more approachable and things like that. I mean, in my spare time I play the cello, have done since I was 4. I didn't show you the picture of me when I am 4, because I'm a bit embarrassed to ask for that. Okay. I also play the Ode to Gamber and the lute. So now I want to get on the real thing. So I want to talk about what's good and what's bad in Debian and things like that. Talk about that. So what's the good in Debian at the moment? So I mean, obviously Stretch is pretty good. And we should all. That's pretty obvious. Like, what's good about Debian? Well, Debian itself, the software. And then this CD case is really cool as well. We're also the upstream of choice for all of these derivatives. I mean, these are the ones I can just find logos in about 2 seconds. So if yours isn't here, don't hit me too much. This is a sign that we're really sort of, people even making new distros today are based on Debian. And that really speaks to what we've built, how flexible we are, how reliable we are as a sort of social project, in a sense of, are we going to go in one direction one day and one in the other? No, I don't think we are. So people can just be very reliable and hedge even their commercial interests onto us, because we're not going to just pull the rug out underneath them and decide to take the operating system in a different direction. Also cool things like, I'm not sure everyone saw this, but we were on Russia Today, during the launch of the Orbital Inspector, which I think was last year. That's pretty cool. Well done, whoever found that. The other nice things is that we're the spearhead of quite a few initiatives. So, I mean, this is slightly blow my own trumpet by referencing reproducible builds here, but what other distros would have pushed this forward? Would they have had the time? Would they have had the long-term vision, the sort of that kind of thing? And I think Debian is really uniquely placed to do these kind of things, where it's sort of a bottom-up approach means that someone can come along one day and say, I think builds should be reproducible, I'm just going to hack on that, let's just see how it goes. And it can go, and this shows that it can clearly go a long way. Another thing that's actually good about Debian is that right now is that although Alioth is a little bit aging, etc., you may have noticed, the fact that we're planning to move away from it, and we're having quite a mature discussion about what software we're going to use and bringing out streams and things like that, I think that shows a real like healthy thing about the project right now. So although this is currently not the best thing in the world, we're moving forward and it's not reached like completely critical point just yet. We're also still having fun. So I'm not sure you can see, but I'm not going to tell you who it is, but someone every month is donating leet cents to Debian. And this is great. This is, yeah. So I think this really shows how we're still like, got a bit of a sense of humor, things like that. And this isn't, we get a lot of donations. And some of them are really heartening. And sometimes you see the names and you think, and the amounts, and you just think, wow, this is great. Like this is, people really care, they still care about Debian in a really meaningful way. And yeah, we still have fun, we still meet up, and we're all here, and we're just having a laugh and things like that. So this was last year in Austria. And I think we really undervalue these meetups. It's not only the hacking we get done when we're here, it's also, you know, I met them in person and it's just so much friendlier. And yeah, we'll go away from this DevConf tired, and there won't be many uploads in the next week, but, well, maybe not. But we'll just feel a bit more connected to the project just by meeting these things. And we that's slightly irrational part of human beings, but I feel like it's a really important. And the more meetings we can arrange, the more meetings we can go to, we'll just all feel better and the project will be a little bit smoother and we'll just enjoy it more. It's just more fun and things like that. So, yeah. So moving on a little bit more, the bad. Well, you know, not everything's great at Debian. So as I mentioned previously, I think we have sort of two main problems in Debian around communication and perception. In terms of communication, that's sort of mostly around, I think, since becoming DPL, it's been about interactions between teams, primarily, rather than personal interactions, because, well, I'll come and talk about that a bit later, but one of the biggest problems, I think, is the expectations people have of teams are often not met, and often that's because the teams themselves are just not in a position to offer something. And so if we all had better expectations that, you know, this team can do this on this time frame, even if that's really long, as long as they knew when they were asking, it would just smooth everything out. Maybe there's a better route. But what I'm seeing at the moment is teams being asked to do things, and it kind of gets dropped because the team has no manpower, and everyone gets a bit stressed, and it's like not one really when that team's purview to begin with, things like that. So I'm not really sure the right solution. I mean, each team could have some sort of page talking about, you know, what we can provide and in what mode and how long you would have to wait to get that. But I'm not sure that formalizing really fits and things like that. In terms of perception, I think we do not the greatest job talking to the quote unquote outside world. These are some random posts on Reddit. Mostly about like firmware, installation, the kind of typical things you might find on any support forum. And it's sometimes quite sad reading these things. And I think we do a much better job at just making it easy for new users, having empathy with the first time user. So when we load the Debian installer or whatever, or things like that, we kind of know the kind of problems with it, but we need to jump out of that and say, what if we were using this for the first time? And that's just really hard in general. And I think it's even harder for hackers and things like that. So yeah, to infringe even more on Clint Eastwood's copyright, what's the ugly in Debian? Because there's, well, obviously, first thing's ugly. So yeah, we still have some very, very bad personal communication. So sending that to a new user is just I don't know words really. Like that, we should be doing that in 2017 to anyone.
We can't read it.
Good. It's a not very welcoming response to a newcomer who may have posted to the wrong list or something like that. But you know, it's a trivial administrative error. We're just going to focus on how big did they get wrong. There's also a fair amount of ugliness behind the scenes, unfortunately. This happens to be, well, you don't want to read this one, quite frankly. It's not even safe for work, I believe. But I mean, that's hate mail to myself and many, but there's also a lot of dramas behind the scenes as well. They're not necessarily ugly, but they're more tragic, and it's just, yeah, these things are in life. But to report on them, really. So what I really want to talk about now is my kind of vision for Debian, and hopefully it will be interesting to you, or what I like about particular aspects of Debian, how we should really crack them up. So this is like the motivation part and things like that. What I've always thought, and then sort of coming from the sort of startup world and things like that, is one question that's always interesting is what is a company or organization betting on? Like, what are they kind of all in on? Like, we're on this idea, if it doesn't work, we kind of go bust. Now that doesn't really fit Debian, but it's just a really interesting framework, a question to ask. So, I mean, you can look at organizations like the Free Software Foundation. They went all in on free software. They didn't try and do other things as well. They just completely bet on that. So, I mean, like, so what is Debian betting on these days? Like, what risks is it taking? What things? And I think we can just take a lot more risks, I think. I mean, this is the rather infamous OpenSSL change, and this could be bad. And with someone said yes, but this is someone taking a risk, and I think we just take a lot more. It's reversible as well. Most of these changes, you can roll them out. So I mean, we have the experimental suite, which I think is completely underused. I mean, what is it? 1-3% of packages have an unstable version. We should use that a lot more, or just unstable. You know, things break. No one's gonna hit you too hard, like they should. I think we're growing a culture where we aren't jumping on people's backs as much, and the more people are less afraid to upload things that are slightly risky, taking more chances and things like that, then that becomes a muscle that grows and with extra use, and you know, we can start to sort of drop our ego even more and things like that and things like that. But it is difficult as well from a personal point of view, because it speaks to people's insecurities if they don't want to be seen making mistakes. But I think that we're at this point where we can tolerate that a bit more. Here's one good example of the intrigued recent email about AppArmor, and we should see a post like this once a week. And sometimes sometimes the ideas will be very well thought through, like this one is, and very extremely well written and argued. I just haven't rebooted yet to actually enable the AppArmor myself. But we should be seeing these once a week having discussions, like big proposal of changes, and we should run with some of them. And maybe AppArmor turns out to be a disaster, but we can just revert it. It's like not a problem. You know? The perfect is the enemy of the good, etc. Here's one example of something that was reversed. That's now been closed. Changed the Node.js binary, and now we're not changing it. We've changed the back or whatever the actual details are. It's fine, you just reverse it. And who's saying, that's silly, the tech committee, they set one way one year and one thing the next. No one's saying that. It's fine. Great. We've moved on. We've changed. Or, yeah. Could you do more of it? Yeah. So that's pretty much all I had to say, really, about... So, yeah. We should also ask for more help. So if people have issues, and this is to basically help the to get over people's like ego and things about trying experimental stuff. So if you do have an idea, I mean, do try stuff in private, of course, but also do make posts like interviews to Debbie Lavelle and Project, so we can try all these interesting new ideas and sort of push Debbie in the right direction in that sense. So I didn't have anything else more to say, and thought I'd leave a lot of it up to any questions people have. I think some people do, so anyway, I want to thank you once again for electing me as leader. And as I say, it's just an honour to be up here and see so many friendly faces and things like that. Anyway, thank you.
Hi, Chris.
Hi.
So, I appreciate I'm probably not even the first person to ask you this yet, but it is a long-standing tradition. Are you going to stand again for DPL next year?
Is that really a tradition?
Oh, hell yes.
He says, trying to avoid the question. I haven't thought about it.
Cool. Are you enjoying the job?
I'm very much enjoying the job. It is quite demanding, takes a fair amount of time, and a different pile of spoons that I'm usually taking from, and that's been personally quite a fulfilling experience, and very informative in teaching me about myself, and growing as a person. Yeah, don't vomit. But yes, I'm very, very much enjoying it. Yeah.
Excellent stuff.
Hi, Chris. My name is Brandon, and I have maybe some notion of the pressures you're under. Hi, everybody. I'm back after 12 years. But not to pull the spotlight onto myself as I want to do, but rather to focus on a point you made, which I want to underscore emphatically, if I could. I think you're right to ask for the project to take a few more risks. The point I really wanted to zoom in on, though, is like your emphasis of the underusage of experimental versus stable. And also, this point ties in with the whole issue of teams getting overworked. I'll tell you firsthand, I haven't really said this in front of a large audience before, but managing the issues between teams was the single hardest aspect of the job for me. I don't think I handled it well. So if you want to say I burned out and left, if you could hang it on any one thing, it was that. Because, you know, even though I was notorious for getting into arguments with people, I really care about everybody in the project then and now. And I'm sure you're experiencing some of this yourself. It's just, it's difficult to work through some of these issues. And the key I wanted to focus here on is expectations management, because that's the phrase that popped into my mind was something that you hear a lot in corporate culture, SLA, service level agreement. And you said, well, do we really want to formalize our teams that much? And I would say, there's a risk in not doing it, which is that people will make assumptions anyway. People are going to accept a certain level of performance from any team, or even in the individual package manager. And if you don't make these explicit, then, you know, 200 different people are going to have, you know, maybe 100 to 120 different ideas differing about what can really come from that. One of the beautiful things about the Debian policy manual and project which, you know, goes all the way back almost to the beginning, is precisely that it establishes that set of expectations. I don't expect team management to be quite so easily codified, but that is the direction that I would recommend that we explore as a project to try and address this issue, because I'm not surprised, but I am sorry to hear that internal team struggles, more between team struggles, continue to be such a large, taking up a large part of your time, as I've seen from your bits. And that's the most wisdom I can offer you with the hindsight that I have. So thank you for taking on that role, and good luck. And the job does definitely have its perks, so please enjoy, in case you don't see me for another 12 years.
After this, you're obviously very welcome. You all know my face now, so I can't be as anonymous as I was before. So anyway, thank you again, and I'll see you around the rest of the week.